Pariyatti Audiobooks presents Gotama the Buddha's Son of Earth, Chapter 2, Buddhaṃ, Saraṇaṃ, Gacchāmi. Written by A.H. Salunkhe, translated by Dhananjay Chavan, and narrated by Parag Sampat. Chapter 2, Buddhaṃ, Saraṇaṃ, Gacchāmi. In this chapter, we will look at journey of Siddhartha from a Gotama to Buddhahood, the journey that is implicit in the name Gotama the Buddha. Let us start this discussion with his renunciation, that is his leaving home. Actually, his journey to Buddhahood started even before that. From childhood, he had a tendency to observe, gather experiences, ask questions and seek answers. Even so, his going forth into homelessness was the first clear visible step in the journey. If his meditation in the field as a child is considered the first major step, then the renunciation would be considered the second major step. There is a traditional view about the Tathagata's going forth. It is said that some astrologers predicted Siddhartha's going forth into homelessness. Suddhodana and Pajapati didn't want their child to leave home and take robes as a sammana. It is said that to prevent his going forth, they took great care to keep him away from all suffering and to provide him with all possible material comfort. In spite of all their efforts, one day Siddhartha saw a sick person, an old person, a dead body, and he saw the suffering. Then he saw a sammana and decided to leave home. This is the traditional belief. The episode of Siddhartha Gautama seeing four sights and leaving home is actually said to have occurred in the life of a previous Buddha, Buddha Vipassi, in Mahapadana Sutta in the Long Discourses. There is no mention in the Tipitaka of such an event occurring in the life of Siddhartha Gautama. The opinion expressed by Dhamanand Kosambi looks fair. He says, all these wonderful stories came to be associated with the life of the Bodhisattva. They came from Mahapadana Sutta. Kosambi bases his inference on the commentarial evidence. The commentary of Mahapadana Sutta gives details of the dialogue that have now come to be associated with the charioteer and Siddhartha. According to the Sutta, this episode is the life of Vipassi Kumara. If this entire episode of four sights has been added to the life of Siddhartha from life of Vipassi Kumara, then even according to the Tipitaka, these sights cannot be said to be the immediate reasons for Siddhartha's going forth. Even the historicity of the existence of Vipassi Kumara and the episode associated with his life is doubtful. There is one more thing that this episode doesn't seem logical. Even a child would find it difficult to believe that Siddhartha did not see any such sights until the age of 29. Didn't he notice his own parents getting old through the years as he grew to the age of 29? If we assume this to be true, then it is tantamount to accepting that he was lacking completely in observation and comprehension. If we look at his discourses after becoming a Buddha, we see that his experiences were rich, varied and vast. Many of his experiences that he details were from the time before his enlightenment. So indefensible is the proposal that he didn't see any of these sights before that there is no need to discuss this further. Eminent scholars such as Kosambi and Dr. Ambedkar also refused to accept these sights as the reason behind his renunciation. Still, this episode of four sights can be explained to have a figurative meaning. Rejecting the traditional reasons of the story of the four sights behind his renunciation doesn't solve the problem. It becomes our responsibility to find other suitable and possible reasons. Two references are important in this context. The first is the discussion on renunciation in Pali texts. The second is the comments by Kosambi on Pali sources. Let us first look at the information given in the discourse to Prince Bodhi and other suttas. These explanations as given in the Tipitaka will explain the reason for his renunciation. The first reason for renunciation is that he thought undergoing physical suffering will give him happiness. Once the Tathagata accepted an invitation by Prince Bodhi for a meal. After the meal, he said to the Tathagata, "Revered Sir, I feel that happiness cannot be achieved through happiness. Happiness can be achieved through suffering." He meant that only austerities involving torture of the body can lead to spiritual upliftment. Then the Tathagata shared with him some of the memories of his life before attaining Bodhi. He said, "I held similar view. I was very young. My hair was black at the time when I left home against the wishes of my parents. I shaved off my mustache and beard, shaved my head and took saffron robes to go forth into homelessness." Another detail about his renunciation is found in the Atadanda Sutta of Sutanipata. The Buddha went forth after seeing his subjects suffer like fish without water. Dhamanand Kosambi developed this theory of the reasons behind Siddhartha's renunciation based on the details from this sutta. Kosambi quotes 3.5 verses at the beginning of this sutta. "Fear comes from arming oneself. Look at how these people fight. I'll tell you how the urge to renounce overcame my being. Seeing people thrashing around like fish in shallow water, all hostile to one another. When I saw this, I became fearful. The world around seemed without essence, all directions trembling. I sought refuge to keep myself safe, but I could find no such place. Seeing people all around in hostile conflict, I became distraught." Third, he thought that renunciation is like an open sky. The middle discourses give yet another possible reason behind his going forth. Once he was dwelling in Vaisali, Satchaka Nigarthaputa came to him. Venerable Ananda saw him coming from a distance. Satchaka was a charlatan and used to think of himself as a scholar. He was critical of the Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha. After approaching the Buddha and exchanging pleasantries, he started a discussion with the Buddha. During the discussion, the Buddha said to him, "Aghivesana, before becoming a Buddha, while I was a Bodhisatta, the thought came to my mind, living a householder's life is problematic. It is a muddy path. Homelessness, on the other hand, is like the open sky. While living a householder's life, it is not possible to live a complete and pure righteous untainted life. Then why shouldn't I shave my head, remove my mustache and beard, take saffron robes and leave home?" He then told Satchaka how he went forth against his parents' wishes, leaving them tearful. A similar explanation is given in Pabbaja Sutta of Sutanipata. He says, "I will now explain which serious analysis inclined me towards renunciation and then give description of my renunciation. The householder's life is full of troubles. It is full of faults. Homelessness is like an open sky. Seeing this, I went forth." The fourth reason for renunciation is given in the middle discourses. Siddhartha left home for a noble search. Just to recap, we are discussing these as we have found the traditional view unacceptable for bodhisattvas leaving home. The Buddha was dwelling in Jaitavana at Savatthi. When the bhikkhus expressed a wish to hear a sermon from the Buddha, Venerable Ananda arranged a talk at the monastery of Ramaka Brahmin. Tathagata explained to the bhikkhus, "There are two kinds of search, noble and ordinary. While being subject to birth, old age, sickness, death, grief, lamentation, to search for things that are also subject to these same qualities is ordinary search. To get attached to son, wife, servants, goats, sheep, hens, pigs, elephants, cows, horses, gold and silver. To become heedless, to become attached to them and try to get these things is ordinary search. On the contrary, to search for peerless Nibbana is noble search." He said that while he was a bodhisattva, he too was engaged in ordinary search. But once the thought, "Why shouldn't I undertake noble search?" entered his head, he went forth into homelessness against the wishes of his parents. In the reference to the above-mentioned reasons, Kosambi's opinion is very important. Based on various details available in Pali literature, Kosambi gives three reasons for the renunciation of Siddhartha Gautama. These are as follows. First, he was anguished by his clansmen taking up arms to fight each other. Second, he thought that the householder's life is full of troubles and faults. Third, he felt that while being subject to birth, old age, sickness, and death, one should not become attached to things with the same characteristics. These three reasons can be linked together. The principal among these three was the constant fights between Sakyans and Koliyas. Kosambi has rejected the traditional view for Siddhartha's going forth and has given his own explanation for the Tathagata's renunciation. The commentaries contain description of conflicts between Sakyans and Koliyas. According to the commentary, the sermon in Atadanda Sutta was given by the Buddha to avert battle between their armies on the issue of water. Kosambi says, "The Sakyans and the Koliyas used to fight over the water of Rohini River. Once, when they reached the bank of Rohini River with their respective armies, the Tathagata stood between the two armies and gave this sermon." We see this description at many places in the commentary on Jataka. But it doesn't look right. It is possible that the Buddha gave sermons to Sakyans and Koliyas. He may have also mediated in their conflicts. But there is no reason to give this discourse on those occasions. The Buddha is explaining in this sutta how he developed an urge for renunciation and why he left home. Due to the dispute over water of Rohini or some such mundane issue, there used to be fights between Sakyans and Koliyas. The Bodhisattva had to decide whether to take up arms or not. But it was not possible to end these conflicts with weapons. Even if they were resolved using force, it would not have ended there. Then the victor would have been fighting the neighboring king, and again with another neighboring king. Thus weapons would be essential for each battle and each victory, but peace would still elude them even after victory. The sons of King Pasenadi and King Bimbisara betrayed and dethroned their fathers. What is the use of these weapons? To fight till the end? The Bodhisattva spurned the path of violence and accepted the non-violent path sans weapons. In short, Kosambi feels that Siddhartha Gautama may have mediated in the conflicts between the Sakyans and the Koliyas, but it is unlikely that he taught the Atadanda Sutta on such an occasion. There used to be hostilities between the Sakyans and the Koliyas even before Siddhartha's going forth. It was during one such conflict that he shunned the path of violence and left home. As explained by Kosambi, this was the background of his homelessness. Kosambi dealt with Siddhartha's renunciation in detail in the play Bodhisattva that he wrote in 1945. In this play, Kosambi put into a fictional play what he thought was the real reason for renunciation, because he clearly found the traditional view unacceptable. In the preface of the play, Kosambi says that he created the fictitious character of Subhadra Kuliya in his play. Here, Kosambi has proposed that after Siddhartha refused to take up arms against the Kuliyas, the general of the Sakyan army threatened him with boycott of his family as well as confiscation of his property. Let us look at the dialogue as penned by Kosambi. When Siddhartha refused to go to war, the general threatened him. "Remember, we may boycott your family and confiscate your lands." Siddhartha requested, "Please don't boycott my family and confiscate our lands. Don't make all the family destitute. If you wish to punish, please punish me alone." To save his family, he said, "I'm willing to be banished from our state. I will become an ascetic and live on my own." When he later briefed his father about what happened in the assembly, he said, "This is why I thought I wanted to be an ascetic. Our family would have been ruined if the Sakyan assembly had confiscated our lands, wouldn't it?" In the publisher's note of the Hindi translation of this play published by the Central Institute of Higher Tibetan Study, Sarnath, the director writes that Kosambi found inadequate, illogical, and improper the traditional view that the four sites were responsible for Gotama's going forth. He put forth Siddhartha's reluctance to take up arms in the bloodshed due to quarrel over water, and consequently, when he was censured by the assembly, he left home. The director adds that the scholar should think about this view. In the preface of this play, D.B. Kelkar writes, "I find this theory put forth by Kosambi logical and rational. Further, I want to add that only after reading this do we get a better grasp of the Buddha's teaching." On the basis of the commentary, Kosambi's view is not historical but a constructive allegory. Thus, Bhadant Anand Kausalyayan proposes that it should be left to the reader to decide what could have led to Siddhartha's going forth. Kosambi's theory is based on Atadanda Sutta, but it doesn't mention clansmen. Even Kosambi's translation uses the words people and subjects. But when he gives the list of three reasons, he uses the words apta, meaning clansmen. Thus the argument becomes somewhat tenuous. It is difficult to accept Kosambi's objections to the commentary. The setting of the Atadanda Sutta given by the commentary is as follows. The Tathagata stood between the two armies when the hostilities escalated into impending war and gave this sermon. This looks unreasonable to Kosambi. If one examines the essence of the sutta, we will find that the sermon not only seems acceptable in that setting, but also appropriate. He wanted to explain to the both armies not to fight, not to quarrel. It was proper that he would tell them on this occasion that such conflicts led to his renunciation, and he had found that the solution is to remove ill will and live in amity. It is noteworthy that this conflict occurred after Siddhartha's enlightenment. By the time of this incident, Gotama the Buddha had come to be revered by general society. There is no basis in Pali literature to say that the conflict had occurred before his renunciation and had led to his decision. The whole theory is Kosambi's imagination. Kosambi's description of how taking up arms would lead to a series of violent battles and its futility is certainly in keeping with the non-violent teaching of the Buddha. But this teaching of peace by Tathagata is applicable to every conflict between humans. He might have seen fights among people, and these probably also included his clansmen. But it doesn't mean that he only had conflicts of his clansmen in front of him. Thus, it seems proper that he left home to address the suffering of people who were distressed like fish in shallow water, And after he became a Buddha, he came back to mediate between the two armies and shared his memories with them. Kosambi mentions the sons of Pasenadi and Bimbisara turning against their parents as an additional factor for renunciation. However, these events occurred a long time after the attainment of Bodhi. Bimbisar continued to rule for a long time after the enlightenment of Siddhartha. It is true that Pasenadi was dethroned by his son Vidudaba, and this resulted in Pasenadi's death. However, Vidudaba's birth, even his mother's marriage to Pasenadi, happened after the enlightenment. Therefore, these sons turning against their fathers could not contribute to the reasons for renunciation. There is one more difficulty. According to the commentary, the Tathagata mediated successfully in the conflict between Sakyans and Koliyas. Whereas, according to Kosambi's hypothesis, Siddhartha left the region without settling the dispute. We see in the Tipitaka that the Tathagata often reminisced about his renunciation. He often described how he left his parents in tears. He never said that he took robes because of the conflict between Sakyans and the Koliyas. He said that he left home to find an end to all suffering. In Mahaparinibbana Sutta, we see that at the end of his life, while giving a sermon to Subhadra, he said that he had left home 51 years ago with the same aim of finding a way out of all suffering. Though Siddhartha was indeed against war, the converse of Kosambi's hypothesis is that, had he not been threatened with social boycott and confiscation of the land of his family, he would have not gone forth, and would have led a householder's life of a Sakyan. There is little evidence to support this hypothesis. Kosambi's hypothesis can be looked upon as a creative license of a poet or a writer. But the Buddha is a historical figure, and hence we have certain obligations when we use that creative license. The commentary too often uses fiction, and when it doesn't pass the test of rational scrutiny, we have to reject it. Had the commentary not mentioned the dispute over water, we would have been left with little to find our way to the true history of this important conflict. Therefore, I feel that we should look at Kosambi's hypothesis as allegory. It is a vivid, persuasive, and handsome allegory that depicts Siddhartha's opposition to violence, bloodshed, and destruction. There is more proof in the connected discourses to refute Kosambi's hypothesis. The discourse states, Mara tried to distract Siddhartha while he was meditating to attain enlightenment. At that time, Tanha, or Trishna, that is craving, a daughter of Mara asks him, "You are meditating in the jungle in grief. Have you lost your wealth? Is that why you are worried? Are you on the run from the law? Why don't you meet people?" Siddhartha responded, "I am meditating in solitude to achieve my goal, to attain peace of mind, to defeat the army of all that appears dear and enticing. Since this gives me happiness, I don't meet people." When asked whether he was on the run from the law, he didn't affirm it. This too goes against Kosambi's hypothesis. Kosambi might say that such a question itself is an indication that something had happened. Counter-argument to it would be that for a solitary person in the jungle, such a question is raised naturally. Anand Kausalyayan has another viewpoint and wants the question about renunciation left to the readers and scholars. He says, "Whatever small indicators we find in the Tipitaka are more in keeping with seeing people wilting around him, all hostile to one another, than the story of the aged, the sick, the dead, and the ascetic." In his childhood, Siddhartha had sat in meditation during festivities. This indicates that his nature was contemplative from childhood. Suddhodana, like any other father, would have been worried by it and might have tried to change his mindset. What was this child absorbed in? He had the sensitivity to look beyond superficial appearances. He had the rare sharp intellect to analyze and comprehend events around him, and the organizing capacity to marshal his experiences meaningfully. To say that once he saw a sick person seems like a childlike explanation. He saw suffering all around. He saw mistakes by men and their lamentations. He was disturbed by what he saw and also felt compassion. His very existence was consumed by the question, why are people miserable, and is it possible to eradicate their misery? It is possible that one or two sad events stirred and heightened his sensitivity or brought urgency to it. The suffering he saw in the people around him must have included suffering of sickness, old age, and death, making him even more compassionate. Though he may not have seen these three sites of suffering one after the other, we can look upon these three sites as symbolic of all kinds of suffering. His own suffering, or that of his near and dear ones, surely was a part of his contemplation, but he set out to find the solution to a universal problem. And through tireless efforts, he found it. He went forth due to the inner yearning of a sensitive mind. All his experiments to find a way out of suffering were congruent with it. Now that we have understood the reasons behind Siddhartha's going forth, let us discuss certain important aspects surrounding the Buddha's renunciation. First, we'll talk about the five dreams. The description in the numerical discourses that the Bodhisattva had five great dreams and these were fulfilled when he attained Bodhi is noteworthy. In the first dream, he saw that the earth was his bed and the Himalayas were his pillow. His left hand was being washed by the eastern sea, the right hand by the western sea, and both his feet by the southern sea. In the second dream, a blade of grass had sprouted from his navel and was touching the sky. Creatures with black heads and white bodies were climbing from his soles to his knees in the third dream. In the fourth dream, he saw that four birds of various colors had flown to his feet from four directions and all had turned white. In the fifth dream, he was walking without touching a mound of filth. Tathagata himself clarified the meaning of these dreams. The first dream meant that he had attained peerless enlightenment. The second dream meant that he had discovered and proclaimed the Noble Eightfold Path. The third dream meant that householders in white clothes became his disciples. The fourth dream meant that all four varnas, classes, become one and get liberated by Dhamma. The fifth dream meant that he would use various material gifts, such as robes and alms food, without attachment, that he would not get attached to worldly things. Even though this description is shown as coming from the Buddha, it is possible that these dreams were described in detail later by someone else. Still, we can say that the seeds of these dreams were present in the mind of Siddhartha when he left home. If we say that he had already seen in his dreams all the significant events that happened after his enlightenment, then all his efforts for enlightenment would be meaningless. It would mean that everything is preordained, predetermined. We should also remember that all these were subjects of contemplation for Siddhartha, not only after he went forth, but also before his renunciation when he was facing storms of question in his mind. Being dissatisfied with what was happening in society, the quest to give it a new positive direction had formed in his mind. Siddhartha had renounced householder's life to attain Bodhi and discover the Dhamma. Bhadant Anand Kausalyayan is balanced in his comment. He says, just as in a chain one link is joined to the next, The goal of his renunciation and its fulfillment were the pious poem which is the Buddha's Dhamma. It is understood that he left home to go to the root of the suffering of people, to find out way to eradicate suffering and to show this path to the people to remove all suffering. The second thing I would like to discuss is that Siddhartha Gautama saw a Samana, not a Sannyasi. Of the four sights that Siddhartha saw, the fourth was a Sannyasi. Though we can take this story literally, we can look at it in another way. We will see later how Siddhartha had got the legacy of the Samana tradition. Kosambi feels that the visit of Asitakala Devala to Suddhodana's house after Siddhartha's birth was probably true. He says, "The story of Rishi Asita predicting Siddhartha's future seems to be an ancient one. We find it in the beginning of the Nalaka Sutta of Sutanipata. It seems that Siddhartha had the opportunity to spend time in the company of various scholars and samanas, or ascetics. When the story says that he saw an ascetic, all it means that he received the heritage of prior samana tradition and that gave a particular direction to his thoughts. Sannyasi is often equated with a Vedic sannyasi. This is not true. The person that Vipassi Kumara saw and is popularly also associated with Siddhartha was not a Vedic sannyasi. He was a Samana. The long discourses describe him as a shaven-headed ascetic with saffron robes. The Vipassi Kumara's charioteer tells him that the ascetic had taken the robes to live a righteous life, to live a life of equality, to perform wholesome actions, for non-violence, and to be compassionate to all beings. When Vipassi Kumara asked the charioteer the reason why the ascetic had shaved his head, the charioteer gave the same reply. It is unlikely that Siddhartha made up his mind by merely seeing an ascetic. It just shows that how he became favorable to the Samana tradition. This effort to decide a sannyasi or a Samana is not a mere useless academic exercise. If we find out whose tradition was his heritage, the sannyasi that seeks moksha or the samana that strives to live a righteous life, we will know better what his inspiration was. He didn't consider the Vedic sannyasa as the way to attain bodhi, but thought that he could reach his goal by becoming a samana. He says that his hair was black when he left home. This means that he left home in the prime of his youth. He left behind a life of great affluence to walk an arduous path. He did this not under any duress or due to any enticement, but with a mind possessed to seek the end of suffering." I would like to now discuss about the Buddha's family during the time of his renunciation. The Buddha said that he left home against the wishes of his parents, and they wept when he left home. Clearly, the description that he left home surreptitiously without informing his family is a flight of poetic imagination. He had discussed his renunciation with his family and had told them about his goal and his decision. The inference of Dhamanand Kosambi looks proper. He says, "It seems that the story that the Bodhisattva rode on his horse Kanthaka with Chana and ran away is totally wrong." These statements of crying make it clear that Suddhodana and Gautami knew that the Bodhisattva was going to become an ascetic and that he did so in front of them against their wishes. The commentary says that on receiving the news of the birth of his son, Siddhartha said, "A Rahu is born. A fetter has arisen." Rahu means obstacle, fetter. Thinking this fetter will make Siddhartha give up the thought of renunciation, Suddhodana named the child Rahula. Some people spice up historical events with such quotable puns. Unfortunately, those who do so don't realize that by creating a fable for a pun, they are depicting the protagonist as irresponsible. This legend suggests that Siddhartha had developed a dislike, an aversion for wife and son. In reality, Siddhartha didn't leave home due to aversion towards his family, but for the lofty goal of finding a way out of suffering for all people. He didn't leave home because he thought it was desirable for the goal, but because it was necessary for the search he was going to undertake. Now, about the name Rahula. The town of Sakyans was named after Kapila Muni, who was an Asura. He was son of Prahlada and the uncle of an Asura named Bali, who is famous as Vairochana Buddha. This means that the people of Kapilavattu followed the Asura culture. Rahu was a great Asura in this culture. Vishnu had cut off Rahu's head while distributing Amruta, the mythical drink that is supposed to make a man live forever, that had surfaced after churning the sea. It is possible that, like Kapila, Rahu was also remembered by the people there. Just as La is added to various words affectionately in Indian languages, like Premala, Snehala, Mridula, Shyamala, La may have been added to Rahu, and thus Rahula came about. This suggests that the name came not because he was looked upon as a fetter, but from tender affection. Lastly, in regards to his family, it is prudent for us to seek forgiveness from Yasodhara. Various stories say that Siddhartha left home while Yasodhara was sleeping. We have seen above that Siddhartha didn't leave home surreptitiously, but after discussion with his family. He said that his parents were crying when he left. It is not possible that Yasodhara didn't know about it when her in-laws were crying. It is not possible that the servants in the house wouldn't tell her. It is true that while recounting his going forth, he talks about his parents, but not about his wife. Whether or not he had obtained her permission for leaving home, it is unlikely that he didn't discuss his renunciation with Yasodhara. What is then the reason behind her omission in his narration? One explanation is that customarily, the elders in the family are approached for permission. Anyway, in spite of Siddhartha's assertions, stories are told about him sneaking out of the house. All great persons in the world often neglect the well-being of their families for the greater good of the society. When King Shivaji went to meet Afzal Khan, he gave priority to society over his family. Various leaders such as Mahatma Gandhi and Nelson Mandela were either married or had responsibility of their family on their shoulders when they joined the freedom struggle. But they neglected their families for a greater goal. The same is true for Siddhartha Gautama in a different field. Even then, we must seek a million pardons from Yasodhara. Her sacrifice, whether made voluntarily or forced on her, is the price paid for the sweet and delicious fruit that humanity has enjoyed for the past 25 centuries, and which innumerable people will continue to enjoy in future. Let us thank her for that. Since she took robes and joined the Sangha, we can say that she supported his decision, even if belatedly. Dhamanand Kosambi quotes Dwight Goddard, "'Twas not through hatred of children sweet, "'twas not through hatred of his lovely wife. Thriller of hearts, not that he loved them less, but Buddhahood more, that he renounced them all." Siddhartha left behind royal affluence, luxuries, and vast fields. He exchanged his rich clothes for the robes of an ascetic. Who told him to do so? Why did he do so? What was the need? An inner obsession motivated him. He didn't seek the affluence of power, wealth, and resources. He wanted the affluence of spiritual knowledge and wisdom. To reach that path, he had to renounce royal luxuries. Siddhartha didn't use an iota of his father's abundant wealth to go higher. He attained a higher state through his own tireless and unremitting efforts, through his creative genius, and through his compassion for suffering humanity. In the next section, we will examine Siddhartha's path towards enlightenment after leaving home. After recounting his renunciation, the Buddha told Prince Bodhi, "I who was seeking the welfare and state of peerless peace went to Alara Kalama. When I expressed the wish to train under his guidance, he happily consented. Soon I perfected his teaching. To what level do you teach Dhamma based on your own experience?" I asked him. He said, "To the state of akinchanyayatana, state of ownership over none, sphere of nothingness." Seeing that I too had faith, effort, awareness, concentration, and wisdom, I attained what he had attained and told him about it. To this he replied, "Friend, it is a gain for me that I have co-practitioner like you. I have gained a good thing. Whatever I know, you know as well. We are equal. Come, let us both look after this congregation." Thus, though he was a teacher, he offered me, his student, equal status and honored me. But I left him because I realized that I could not attain the highest goal with his teaching. Then I went to Uddak Ramaputta. There too I attained what he taught. The commentary says that Uddak Ramaputta himself only knew theory and attained it after Siddhartha told him about it. He too then requested me to be a teacher alongside him. He used to teach absorptions till the state of nevasanya na asanya, state of neither perception nor non-perception. Finding it inadequate to reach the highest goal, I left. Seeking supreme welfare, I wandered Magadha and reached Sena Nigama in Uruvela. The land, the woods, the flowing river were delightful. The town was well established and with pleasing surroundings. Finding it suitable for meditation, I sat there. These three similes that I had not heard before came to my mind. The gist of what he told Prince Bodhi is, suppose there were a wet piece of wood lying in water and someone with a dry piece of wood came and tried to rub the two to create fire. Would he be successful? Prince Bodhi replied, "No. The piece of wood is wet and lying in water, so it's not possible to kindle fire with it. It will be a tiring and frustrating task." This is what happens with samanas and brahmanas. If they indulge in sensual pleasures and have not extinguished lust within, they will be tired and distressed but will not attain enlightenment. This was the first simile. If the wet wood is lying on land, it still cannot generate fire. Similarly, those who have given up sensual pleasures but have not extinguished craving within will not attain enlightenment. This was the second simile. If a dry piece of wood is lying on dry land, then it can certainly produce fire. Similarly, those who do not indulge in sensual pleasures and have extinguished the craving within can attain enlightenment if they make proper efforts. This was the third simile. Then the Buddha said, "I started making efforts, with teeth clenched, tongue pressed against the roof of my mouth, crushing mind with mind. I exerted such great effort that sweat ran from my armpits. My efforts were similar to a strong man seizing a weaker man by the head and beating him down, constraining him and crushing him. I tried breathing less meditation by stopping all in-breaths and out-breaths through my mouth and nose. A time came when the deities said, 'Samana Gotama has died.' Some other deities responded by saying, 'Samana Gotama is not dead, he cannot die.' This is how the arhats, liberated ones, dwell. Then I thought of giving up all food. Some deities advised me, 'Don't give up food. If you do give up food, we will infuse heavenly food into the pores of your skin, I thought that if I claim to be fasting and if these deities infuse food into the pores of my skin, then it will amount to lying. Therefore, I requested them not to do so. Then I decided to take a little food. I started taking a handful of bean soup or lentil soup or vetch soup or pea soup. Because of lack of nutrition, my body became extremely weak. My limbs became like jointed segments of a slender vine. My backside became like a camel's hoof. My spine stood out like corded beads. My ribs jutted out as gaunt as the cracked rafters of old buildings. My eyes sank down in their sockets and looked like a gleam of water sunk deep in a well. My scalp withered like a black gourd shrivels and withers in the wind and sun. When I touched the skin of my abdomen, I felt my backbone. Such became my state. If I went to answer the call of nature, I would faint and fall. When my body was touched, hair would fall off. Some saw me and said, "Samana Gotama is black." Some would call me dark, and some would say I was color of a fish. My clear, bright complexion had vanished due to eating so little. But in spite of putting up with such pains, I didn't attain the highest goal. Then I thought, could there be another path to enlightenment? While thinking thus, I remembered that while sitting in the cool shadow of the rose apple tree on my father's field, secluded from sensual pleasures and unwholesome states, I had experienced the first absorption. I thought that this could be the path to enlightenment. I started taking food again because I felt that it was not possible to continue my efforts with so frail a physique. At that time, 5 ascetics were staying with me because they thought that once I attain enlightenment, I would teach them the Dhamma. When I started partaking food, they left me, thinking that I had strayed from my path and had become a materialist. With nourishment, I regained my strength and started dwelling in the first, second, third, and fourth absorptions, that is, jhanas. After this, the Tathagata told him how he had attained enlightenment and set the wheel of Dhamma in motion. In the discourse on the great roar of lion, of middle discourses, the Tathagata shares with Sariputta the memories of his severe austerities. The Tathagata said that when he was not enlightened, he too felt that happiness could not be attained through happiness, but only through suffering. This was a belief of many people at that time that one could not attain truth without enduring severe physical pain. They believed that enduring harsh austerities took one to lofty spiritual heights. Prince Bodhi felt this way, and Siddhartha too was under the sway of this thought for some time. Siddhartha was searching for the lost road to Nibbana. No one had ventured upon it for a long time. He worked tirelessly and relentlessly, always with wisdom by his side. The dark path through the forest of ignorance was full of obstacles. We will now discuss the hindrances that Siddhartha encountered and the sagacity with which he overcame these hurdles in detail. The phrase "Kim Kusala Gavesi" describes Siddhartha's journey. Kusala is wholesome. Kim Kusala is what is wholesome. Gavesi is one who searches. He also described it as the journey undertaken with the aim to achieve the highest peace. He wasn't influenced by the mere desire to reject something or rebel against something. He had set out to achieve something that was beneficial and joyous. His effort was not a negative statement, but originated from positive motivation. Siddhartha was not content with just small gains on the path. After leaving home, he reached Alar Kalama's monastery. His own town was named Kapilavattu, which indicates major influence of Kapila Muni, the founder of Sankhya philosophy. It seems Kalama too was a great Sankhya teacher. We feel respect for him for his honorable conduct towards Siddhartha. The Tathagata himself expressed gratitude towards him for it. We come to know some facets of Siddhartha's personality from the description of his stay at Alara Kalama's monastery. He said that he acquired knowledge from Kalama with the ease with which we move our lips. This means that he had an ardent thirst for knowledge, as well as an immense capacity for quick comprehension. Siddhartha articulated his aspirations confidently. In addition, he understood his own strengths. He grasped that he had the ability to master Kalama's teaching. He declined the offer by Kalama to lead his congregation because he had set his eyes on a much higher goal. He didn't want to be distracted by minor achievements on the road and break his journey towards his final goal. Therefore, though respectful to Kalama, he left his monastery. Later, Uddhak Ramputta went a step further and offered Siddhartha the sole leadership of his disciples. But Siddhartha wasn't tempted and left him too. Siddhartha was pleased with the surrounding at Uruvela. When he reached there, he found the land, the woods, the river, and the village delightful. He felt that this was an ideal place for meditation. This makes it clear that he loved beauty in nature. In fact, his narration makes it clear that peaceful and pleasant surroundings are helpful on the journey to the highest goal. The three similes that we have described earlier are very meaningful. If a piece of wood is wet and put in water, it cannot generate fire. If the mind is defiled and one is indulging in sensual pleasures, one cannot reach the ultimate reality. If a wet wood is put on dry earth, it still can't generate fire. Therefore, even if one gives up sensual pleasures outwardly, but if the mind remains defiled, one can't comprehend the truth. Finally, if the wood is dry and is put on dry earth, it can generate fire. Thus, if the mind is not defiled and one is not drowned in sensual pleasures, one can comprehend the truth. The Bodhisattva started his meditation keeping in mind the essence of these similes. The Tathagata experimented a lot to attain Bodhi. Attaining even a minor goal requires planning and consistent effort. One has to try and give up trials that fail. This takes time. One cannot sow seeds and reap harvest the next moment. Consistency, continuity, and a rational approach takes one to the goal. To attain a higher goal, one needs all these qualities to a far greater degree. The Tathagata once explained through a parable the difference between a deed hurriedly done and a deed achieved with great devotion with long-term efforts. This will help us understand the value of his efforts for liberation. The parable is from Tiknipata of the Numerical Discourses. Once the Tathagata was dwelling in Deer Park of Isipatan near Varanasi. One day he called the bhikkhus and told them a story of a king named Sachetana. Once the king said to his chariot maker, "O chariot maker, there is going to be a war after 6 months. Will you make me a pair of wheels for it?" The chariot maker answered that he will. Then he completed one wheel 6 days before 6 months were over and informed the king about it. The king then said, "There will be a war in 6 days. Is the pair of new wheels ready?" He assured the king that he would make it ready in time. He made the second wheel in the next 6 days and went to the king with the pair of new wheels. The king looked at the two wheels and asked him, "O chariot maker, is there a difference in the two wheels? For I see none." Chariot maker replied, Your Majesty, indeed they are different. Let Your Majesty observe for himself. First, he pushed the wheel he had made in 6 days, rolling on the ground. After going some distance, the wheel lost speed, lost balance, and fell down. Then he set in motion the wheel that had taken almost 6 months to make. After going some distance, this wheel also lost speed, but remained upright. The king asked him why it was so. He explained that the motion of the first wheel was crooked, faulty, and irregular. Its spokes and axle too were faulty. On the other hand, the motion of the second wheel, that took much longer time to make, was straight, flawless, and smooth. Its spokes and axle were faultless. At the end of the story, the Tathagata told the bhikkhus that he himself was the chariot maker. Just as the chariot maker was skilled in removing crooks, flaws, and weaknesses from wood, the perfectly enlightened one was skilled in removing crooks, flaws, and weaknesses in action, speech, and mind. The bhikkhus whose faults are not yet rectified are like the wheel made in 6 days, and those whose faults are all removed are like the perfect wheel that took almost 6 months to make. Therefore, they should make their actions, speech, and mind flawless. The moral of the story is that to make oneself perfect and flawless, one has to make careful efforts for a long time. It also means that one has to follow the guidance of a teacher like the Tathagata for a long time. We perform many mental, verbal, and bodily actions. If you want good results from these actions, you have to guard your actions, speech, and mind. It is not necessary to take the words, "I was the chariot maker," as a historical truth. What is important is that the chariot maker had the skills to remove flaws from wood. The Tathagata showing oneness with the chariot maker does help in one sense. Chariot makers are what is now called a blue-collar members of the society. The Tathagata thus implied that the chariot maker was his equal in prestige. Just like the care showed by the chariot maker in making the first wheel, Siddhartha also took great care in his efforts to attain liberation. After thinking about the three similes, Siddhartha tortured his body in many ways. He also thought of giving up food completely. Ultimately, rather than giving it up completely, he reduced it to such small quantities that he became frail and his body lost all its strength. In one sense, it was good that he did all this and found it useless. He could then claim to know from his own experience that torturing oneself did not take one any closer to his goal of enlightenment. Realizing that all his austerities were in vain, he started taking proper diet. These and other experiments lasted for about 6 years. The Buddha told the bhikkhus about the need for proper diet even after attaining enlightenment. He was once dwelling in Savatthi in Jetavana. Once he gave a sermon on 4 kinds of nutrition needed for every being. The first of these is food, solid or liquid. Thus, he didn't believe in fasting because the body needs food to survive. It was not an easy decision for him to eat proper food. When a man undertakes a journey towards a high ideal, he is watched by many. People analyze his behavior. If he changes course, they doubt him and make allegations against him. They feel that he has betrayed his ideal. Siddhartha's companions turned out to be no exceptions and acted in this way. They left him thinking that he had strayed from his path. These are life's testing moments. It is not easy to stick to one's new decision when companions abandon you. It takes courage to walk alone. An inner conviction is necessary to walk on the new path without hesitation. This is what Siddhartha did. He remembered the meditation from his childhood and gained confidence that it was the proper way to know oneself, to know nature, and to discover the truth. After attaining enlightenment too, the Buddha's fearless resolve was evident many times. Here are a few examples. Once the Buddha was staying at Vulture Peak Mountain near Rajgir. In the dark of the night, he was sitting under the open sky. There was a soft drizzle. At that time, the evil Mara started pushing big boulders in his direction. To which the Tathagata replied, "Even if you push the entire vulture's peak, there will be no trembling in the mind of the Buddha." Whatever stand he took, whatever view he espoused, came from his own experience. He followed it all his life with great determination. Pressure and intimidation had no effect on him. We see this in Suchi Loma Sutta of the Connected Discourses. Once the Tathagata was dwelling near Gaya, two augurs, Khara and Suchi Loma, decided to test him to see if he was a real Samana or a fake one. Suchi Loma came and collided against him. The Buddha moved to one side. Then Suchi Loma asked him, "Samana, are you afraid of me?" The Buddha replied, "Friend, I do not fear you, but your touch is not good." Suchi Loma then threatened him, "Samana, I will ask you a question. If you don't answer me, I will make you mad. I will tear your heart out, or I will seize you by your feet and throw you across the Ganges." The Tathagata replied, "There is none who can make me a lunatic or tear my heart, or who can seize my feet and throw me across the Ganges. Still, go ahead and ask your questions." And then the Tathagata answered all the questions put to him. Let us now examine Siddhartha's partaking of food after his austerities. Nidanta Katha of Commentary on Jataka describes an event after Siddhartha's five companions left him. At that time, in the village Ain Uruvela, there was a family named Senani. Sujata was a daughter of the family. On coming of age, she had prayed to the tree deity, a banyan tree, and said, "If I am married into a suitable family and beget a son as first offspring, each year I will spend 100,000 in your worship." When she gave birth to a son after marriage, she kept her promise. She prepared a milk pudding. It was a full moon day of Vesaka. She decided to make the offering in the morning and asked her slave maid Punna to clean the premises of the banyan tree. The Bodhisattva had seen five dreams on the night before and thinking, "I will surely become a Buddha," came and sat down under the same banyan tree in the early morning. Punna saw him under the tree. She thought that the tree deity had appeared to receive offering from Sujata. She rushed back and told Sujata what she had seen. Sujata was thrilled. She told Punna, "From today, you are my elder daughter." She gave Punna jewelry befitting her daughter and went to the tree with a golden bowl containing milk pudding. She too thought that the Bodhisattva was a tree deity. She put down the bowl containing the milk pudding. She then went to him with a golden pot with scented water. Bodhisattva didn't have his usual earthen pot, so he extended his cupped right hand and accepted the water offered by her. Then she offered the bowl of milk pudding to him. When he looked at her, she assured him, "It is offered to you. please partake it and dwell as you wish. She saluted him and said, just as my wish has been fulfilled, may your wish too be fulfilled. Saying this, she returned with an indifference towards the bowl worth 100,000, as if it was an old leaf. The Bodhisattva got up and circumambulated the tree. Then he took the bowl and went to the bank of the Naranja River. He put down the bowl on the bank and went in the river to bathe. After the bath, he ate the sweet milk pudding in the bowl. Then he took the bowl in his hand and thought, if I am going to become the Buddha today, this bowl will flow in the opposite direction of the current. But if I am not going to become a Buddha, may it flow with the current. Thinking thus, he put the bowl in the river. It reached the center of the current and, like a speeding horse, started flowing in the opposite direction of the current. There is clearly an exaggeration in the description by the commentary. It is also influenced by the veneration that the Tathagata received later due to his teaching. We need not take it literally. Still, it has important allegorical meaning. Siddhartha Gautama became enlightened on the night of the full moon of Vaisakha after partaking the milk pudding offered by Sujata. Two offerings are of highest importance in the Buddha's life. One after he attained Bodhi and the other after which he attained Mahaparinibbana. Sujata thus became immortal in human history. Details such as she was going to spend 100,000, she gave water to Bodhisattva in a golden water pot, the milk pudding was offered in a golden bowl, are not important. It is possible that the water pot and bowl were earthen, but the purpose for which Sujata used them made them far more valuable than gold. It is also possible that Sujata was from an ordinary poor village family. Anyway, there is no problem accepting the commentary's version that she was from a rich family. The most important thing is her discerning faith and goodwill with which she encouraged Siddhartha, may your wish be fulfilled. Indeed, there should be no doubt that even great men derive strength from the goodwill of common people. Here, certain aspects need to be clarified. I will give my best attempt to demystify and separate facts from fiction. Punna brought the news of the tree deity. Pleased by the news, Sujata set her free from bondage. Moreover, she made Punna her elder daughter and adorned her with jewelry. A slave girl became a noble woman, became Sujata's daughter. It is as if it was the preview of the changes Siddhartha was going to wrought in society after becoming a Buddha. It is also immaterial whether it really was a full moon night. On that night, a full moon of wisdom had arisen, helping to complete the lives of incomplete men. It is possible that the slave girl's name was not Punna, literally meaning complete. As long as she was a slave, she was Apunna, literally meaning incomplete. She became Punna later. From that day until now, countless people have become Punna and will continue to become Punnas. It is obvious that the bowl floating in the direction opposite to the current of river is a parable, not a historical fact. However, this doesn't make the metaphor meaningless, false, deceptive, or full of blind faith. To consider it thus will amount to taking music out of human life, taking inspiration out of poetry, and rendering all figure of speech in poetry meaningless. We should consider the bowl floating in the opposite direction as a delightful symbol of Dhamma. The Buddha himself said that his Dhamma goes counter to the current. All his life, he endeavored to turn the thinking of the society opposite to the established traditional thinking. All his life was a journey against the flow. In India, even today, most of that journey has to be made opposite to the flowing current. The commentary on Jataka says that Siddhartha, after eating Sujata's milk pudding, was going for meditation. A grass cutter named Sothiya, Swastika, gave him 8 fistful of grass to use as a seat. This is entirely believable story, and the grass cutter thus became a benevolent supporter of human society. However, one detail of the story seems to have been added in retrospect. Tathagata showed the Noble Eightfold Path to humanity. The 8 fistfuls were imagined as a prior indication of the Noble Eightfold Path. To accept this is to agree that the discovery of the Noble Eightfold Path was predetermined, takes credit away from Siddhartha's efforts. All that should matter is that the grass cutter gave grass to Siddhartha for his seat. It is also noteworthy that Siddhartha didn't use deer skin or tiger skin as he was opposed to killing of animals. It is said that when Siddhartha got up from his seat after attaining Bodhi, wherever he stepped, a lotus bloomed. Even today in Bodh Gaya, the figures of those lotuses are shown. Clearly, it is not factual as it is against the laws of nature. Still, it is a meaningful metaphor. It means that wherever on earth a compassionate wise man steps, it is as if flowers bloom there, and the earth becomes fragrant with the scent of wisdom and compassion. For the next 45 years, he freely distributed the wisdom acquired at that time. The fragrance of the great Dhamma touched the lives of countless people. It is as if the fragrance proclaims the essence of reality of the universe and shows the way to make human life bright and wholesome. Dhamanand Kosambi says while describing the Tathagata, the Buddha, the most fragrant flower of human race. His face brightened after attaining Bodhi. The Buddha set towards Varanasi to teach Dhamma to the 5 former companions. Upaka Ajivika saw him between Uruvela and Gaya and said, "Friend, your bearing looks pleasing. Your complexion is clear and bright." His newly acquired wisdom was no ordinary thing. Its grandeur can be gauged by the fact that people have been venerating that knowledge for the past 25 centuries. It is only natural then that Siddhartha's face had become radiant. His bearing had become pleasing and his whole persona was sparkling with a magnificent glow. The light of this glow dispelled darkness in the entire world. The glow of the Buddha is incomparable. Darkness hinders eyesight and doesn't allow proper comprehension of things. Naturally, any light that removes darkness helps one become better sighted. But not all lights are the same. Connected Discourses lists 4 things that give light. Sun shines during the day, moon at night, fire lights up at various places during day and night. But the greatest light is the light of the Buddha. His glow is unsurpassed. The light of the sun is essential and beneficial for life. But the light of knowledge brightens up life to a far greater extent. In the light of the Tathagata's Bodhi, innumerable people started living a bright life. The light of Bodhi was not the glow of the personality of Siddhartha Gautama before he became enlightened. It was the light of a Buddha, a light of flame of true knowledge. Wisdom, punya, has been described in poetic terms and yet realistically in the numerical discourses. The world has 4 glows, that of sun, moon, fire, and wisdom. Among these, the Buddha told the bhikkhus, the glow of wisdom is superior. To underscore the specialty of the light of wisdom, Additional words were used: glow, brightness, light, flame, in the four suttas. When we see the lofty height of humanness attained by Siddhartha Gautama after enlightenment, we feel the glow of Sambuddha is truly brighter than the glow of the sun and the moon. We then understand how someone keen to attain Bodhi should endeavor. A verse by Matri Chaita is fitting. Your conduct is that of a saint, though none has told you to do so. You are compassionate and caring without any reason or expectation. You are a friend to strangers, those who have no friends. You are a brother to those with whom you have no personal relation. When we look at the life of the Buddha, we find that every word in Matri Chaita's description is true. Matri Chaita has thrown light on the perfectly balanced attitude of the Buddha in a verse. He states that Buddha is an ideal of how one man can have untainted relations with so many different people from so many different strata of society. He says, without having envy for those who have something more, without humiliating those who have something less, and without competing with those who were equal, you became supreme in the world. To eradicate suffering was a lifelong goal of the Tathagata. One major cause of human misery is the disharmony among people. Some people envy, hate, and malign those who are superior in power, wealth, prestige, beauty, and make a petty attempt to prove themselves superior. They try to crush, intimidate, and enslave those who are weaker and thus reaffirm their superiority. They try to compete with their equals and to surpass them, which creates stress and strain. One who looks upon all as equal, who doesn't think of others or oneself as superior or inferior, lives a joyful life, and this joy makes him a superior person. He lives a happy life and creates joy in the life of others. A human being reaches that height after attaining Buddhahood. This beautiful description by Matri Chaita shows us how to live a blissful life. We don't have many dialogues of any other person in Indian history as we have of the Buddha in the Tipitaka. And this superiority is not merely numerical. We have in front of us an immeasurable treasure of deep meaning. What a vast heritage, thrilling and enlightening, educating and enthusing. And how do we respond? Except for a few, most Indians have retracted their senses to avoid being touched by that wisdom and compassion, have closed their eyes to avoid seeing him. We have closed the doors of our mind and heart to prevent the entry of even a speck of that Bodhi. We have turned our intelligence into barren sand so that its life flow should get lost before it reaches us. Those who don't thus recoil and say Buddhaṃ Saraṇaṃ Gacchāmi don't take refuge in a particular person or in the person named Siddhartha Gautama. They take refuge in the supreme enlightenment attained by one's own efforts. They wish to seek guidance from that enlightenment and want to make it the foundation of their lives. Professor Shanti Bhikshu Shastri conveys this succinctly and effectively in his modern Sanskrit epic poem Buddha Vijaya Kavyam. Buddhaṃ hi sharanam gatva te jnanam sharanam gataha. They took refuge in the Buddha means they took refuge in that loftier knowledge. Buddhaṃ sharanam gacchami means I take refuge in myself. If we want to acquire that wisdom, that superior knowledge, we must rid ourselves of our pettiness. Let us not draw back. Let us open our senses. Let us open our eyes and feast them on the Tathagata. Let us create a little opening in our minds for his teaching. let our mental landscape become verdant by the flow of his teaching. Let us say, Buddhaṃ, Saraṇaṃ, Gacchāmi. When we say that, we don't get sullied or blackened or reduced. When we embrace wisdom, we imbibe knowledge. We respond to the call of prudence. We respond to the call of life itself. Let us be mindful that the Tathagata was not interested in the chanting of this phrase like a mantra. He wanted us to commit to logical knowledge by his declaration. The Buddha is not alien to us by any means. He is not our enemy. In reality, he is an external form of our inner strengths. He is the essence of our entire being. He is exactly what we will be if we blossom completely. Rather, we are his undeveloped precursor and he is our developed result. Buddhaṃ Saraṇaṃ Gacchāmi means not only I take refuge in wisdom, it also means I take refuge in myself. Therefore, this refuge is untainted by undue servility or helplessness. This refuge makes us familiar with ourselves. It creates self-confidence in us. The Buddha is the compassionate heart of man. It is his discerning head. Refuge in the Buddha also means a proper balance in the cool shadow of compassion and the light of wisdom in our own personality. Once while watching a 7-year-old girl saying Buddhaṃ Saraṇaṃ Gacchāmi, I remembered my childhood and felt that if I had heard and understood this fine expression in childhood, I would have avoided so many potholes and rough patches on the road of my life's journey. When I utter this expression, I do so with joy that I have crossed all obstacles. I have found my essence and am realizing the meaning of my existence.